لساني يفقه قولي. اللهم افتح فتوح العارفين، اللهم افتح علينا حكمتك، وانشر علينا رحمتك يا ذا الجلال والإكرام، يا ذا الجلال والإكرام، يا ذا الجلال والإكرام. الحمد لله، praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is right to be praised, alhamdulillah, for the blessed majlis, the blessed opportunities that we have. These are segments of our lives that we will see like shining examples of Allah's ni'mah upon us. On the Day of Judgment, when we brought our lives, and no doubt that day is going to come when every one of us has to be standing in front of our Lord, and our lives, the book of our lives, will be presented in front of us. Every single thing, لا يغادر صغيرة ولا كبيرة إلا أحصاها. Not even a single little minute detail will be left out. You will be even surprised, as Allah says in the Quran, what kind of a book is it? That it hasn't even left out the minutest of details that even you forgot. How many of us can even remember things from like yesterday or the week before or the month before, the year before, years before? That book has recorded everything, every single thing in your life. And at that time, even if you see your life as doom and gloom, and nothing's going to be pleasing you, it's going to be these moments where you're going to see when you were given that tawfiq from Allah, that divine assistance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to be from amongst those who are in a state of obedience in this very moment. That is the time when we'll be saying alhamdulillah, we wish that we would have done more. And that's not only at the first instance when you see that, the beautiful light in that segment of your life. But what about when you see how much Allah gives you upon the blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I will give for every single good that you do, and nothing will be left short. Then you will wonder and you wish why you didn't do every part of your life. We have this opportunity as if we've been sent back in time. We've been to Allah, we've seen right in front of Allah, and we've been asked for another time, and Allah has given us that time. And at that time that when we've been sent back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are here right now. What are we going to do different? It's for each and every one of us to ponder upon now. What are we going to do different from the time now until we have to face our Allah? Every single thing that our Sadiq al-Masduq sallallahu alayhi wasallam informed us of that day is exactly Mahajjat al-Bayda, clear as a clear day and a plain ground that's in front of you. There is no iwaj, there's no crookedness inside of that day. There's no crookedness inside of that plain field. Everything is clear for you to see. What he said about the Day of Judgment is going to happen exactly how he sallallahu alaihi wasallam said it's going to happen. And everything at the time, what he sallallahu alaihi wasallam informed us of these times that we live in, is going to happen exactly as he sallallahu alaihi wasallam said is going to happen. When we were kids, we would almost read about these signs at the end of time, and we would say, what a weird time that's going to be. Now we're almost living it. We are living it. I've seen that in my short time, and I haven't lived that long. What about the people? If we could go back in time and speak to the Sahaba, when they were hearing these, they said, well, people will really come, sayakuna lakum al-zaman, that they will really come upon you time, that you would find ikhtilafan kathira, that you find real differences of opinions, where you would see children standing on pulpits and giving khutbahs. And people will be following these immature little boys, apart from these ones where in the previous times that they would look to the elders of the community, they would look to these ulama of the community, and they would be on siha and calmness and good. And the Prophet ﷺ says, when you see that time come, you're going to see great corruption in the land. When you see إِذَا وُسِّدَ الْأَمْرُ إِلَىٰ غَيْرِ أَهْلِهِ فَانْتَذِرِ السَّاعَةِ, the Prophet ﷺ says, when you see that leadership is given to people who do not deserve it, get ready for the end times. We are living that time. We are living a time when the norm of the day is that no one has taqwa. The norm of the day. When in the previous times it would be the norm of the day that everybody would be muttaqi. We have forgotten what a great ni'mah just fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are reading a beautiful hadith today in class. When the Sahaba, they heard a hadith, a khutbah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they had to explain it. And he was explaining, he goes, بَخُطْبَةٍ بَلِيغًا. He says, it's the most eloquent of a khutbah. What do we class as an eloquent khutbah? What's an eloquent khutbah? Or somebody who's very eloquent, somebody who's got a beautiful voice, somebody who makes you laugh and makes you cry sometimes. No, that's not a khutbah. That's not a bayan. That's not a lecture. The Sahaba had a mi'yar akhar, that they had a different gauge of how they would see a beautiful speech. They said, he says, wajilat qulub. First one he says when the hearts, he says, when we sat in his gathering, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our hearts would be filled with fear of Allah. He was a man of less words and more action, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the little words that he said, they were impacting so much that you walked out of that majlis fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you forgot who Allah was, if you forgot the fear of Allah, he would remind you in that majlis. وَظَرَفَتِ الْعُيُونَ. And he says the second thing was that we noticed in the majalis of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the eyes would normally begin to weep and cry because of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Where are the majalis? And where are those who give the khutbahs like that? They're around. We just have to find them and stay connected to them. Stay around in majalis. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, if you can't cry, then at least try to cry, just to look like you're crying. Because Allah loves that so much, especially in the end part of the night. Just get up and cry in front of Allah for the sins that you have done, for the shortcomings of your life. By Allah, look, and if we everyone's buzzing off this beautiful sunshine and it's really good, it's alhamdulillah, ala kulli hal. But something that we should really try to understand, and the people of my teachers, when they look at this kind of weather, they're scared. Is it because of our sins? And these are people that are, mashallah, they don't sin. These are people that, mashallah, even if they did sin, that they turn immediately to Allah and ask for forgiveness. They said, is it because of our sins that Allah is withholding the rain? When's the last time we saw rain? And the time before the Dajjal comes, we know that one third of the rain, one year, one third of the rain will be withheld. We're seeing in our front of our eyes what's happening in South Africa. And now we're seeing what's happening over here with these fires. It's uncontrollable. And the specialists in this field are saying the only thing that can bring it down, despite all of our technologies, is going to be that which Allah sends down. Only thing that can control this fire. On the second year after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says before Dajjal comes, two-thirds of the rain will be withheld. Is that the time that we're seeing now? The oncoming, the onset of this time. And in the last year before he comes, it's going to be all of the rain is going to be withheld. And all of the produce of the earth is going to be withheld. Is that the time that we're seeing? We should be crying. We should be fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These majalis, if they don't catapult us into a realm of fearing Allah, then we are wasting our time. If they don't get us closer to the prophetic way sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have wasted our time. We haven't come with the proper intention, and we haven't set these majalis up with the proper intention. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us purity in our intentions, inshallah. And we ask Allah to make us truly these majalis transformative, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us pure taqwa of Allah, that it becomes a ha'il and a barrier between us and our sins.
Amen.
By way of inshallah tabarruk and seeking blessings from the beautiful words of the Musannif alayhi rahma and the beautiful shamail of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we stopped on a beautiful moment when we were describing the beautiful nature of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we were speaking about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we were speaking about how his beauty of his face was, and how beauty his physique was, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him beautiful, and he made him pure, and he made him pure in every single manner and way. These are our words. And what we describe him are the words of the companions of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that we do naqal of, that we're just trying to emulate their words. Somehow we can be seen to be like the Sahaba, inshallah, so that we can be beloved to Allah's Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we can be beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's just naqal. That's what we are. But the reality is, and the reality really, really is, that we cannot praise his beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as Allah can praise his beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's why the Sharih, he mentions, he says, min fada'ilihi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam anna al-haqqa subhanahu wa ta'ala dhakar a'da'ahu udwan fit tanzeel. He says, you've heard the words of the Sahaba, how they describe the beautiful, magnificent character and his physical description of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so that we can somehow close our eyes and go into a zone where we can see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam based on what we know of him through the words of the Sahaba. That is a little attempt. But Musannif is saying that he goes, now let's look and delve in. And he says, no, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has described his Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Quran. And every feature of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is described in the Quran. And he says, because وَذَكَرَهُ بِجُمْلَتِهِ فَذَكَرَ وَجْهُهُ. He begins by mentioning the beautiful ayat, where he mentions the face of the Rasul, the blessed face of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where Allah says, قَدْ نَرَى تَقَلُّبَ وَجْهِكَ. He says, we indeed see you turning your face, Mubarak, towards the sky. That's what he wanted to, what we said, جُلَّ نَذْرِهِ, didn't we say, جُلَّ نَذْرِهِ الْمُلَاحَظَةِ. And he says most of his eyes used to be like a little glances, and his eyes would be facing towards the ground more than he would ever be looking up. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions قَدْ نَرَى تَقَلُّبَ وَجْهِكَ, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the beautiful face of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we can say وَجْهِكَ, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said those words. That is the beautiful description of the face of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, by the words of Allah. He says, وَأَيْنَيْهِ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions his eyes, وَلَا تَمُدَّنَّ عَيْنَيْكَ, and don't stretch forth your eyes, your blessed eyes, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, those eyes who saw Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes them in the Quran. وَلِسَانُهُ, and he mentions the beautiful Mubarak tongue of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَإِنَّمَا يَسَّرَنَاهُ بِلِسَانِكَ, by your tongue, O Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, وَيَدِهِ وَيَدَهُ وَأُنُقَهُ, he says his hands and his blessed his neck sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَلَا تَجْعَلْ يَدَكَ مَغْلُولَةً إِلَىٰ أُنُقِكَ, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions his two words, his blessed hands and his blessed neck sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَصَدْرِهِ الشَّرِيف, and the blessed chest of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. أَلَمْ نَشْرَحْ لَكَ صَدْرَكَ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the beautiful chest. That beautiful chest was yani opened and cleansed. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that we have yani expanded that beautiful chest of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa qalbihi nazala bihi ruhul amin ala qalbika. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the beautiful yani heart of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that we revealed it upon your heart, O Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this beautiful Quran. وَجُمْلَتُهُ فِيهِ وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ, and every single part, yani in a general manner he mentions, and we have indeed sent upon you, we have indeed given you خُلُق عَظِيمٍ, the great, great, a lofty character sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. That he's given inshara. All the other ones they mentioned in the Quran, that's your homework, go find it. Look into the Quran and search out these beautiful verses. If we want to look, that's why Aisha, the hadith thing Sidi mentioned, he said that, he goes, when they were asked, he says, what was the character of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam like? What did Aisha read? He says, Ala taqra'ul Quran. He says, have you not read the Quran? Why are you asking me that? Because if you look, what when we open the pages of Surah Yasin, you're reading Yasin wal Quran al Hakim. I'm seeing my Habib al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When you open Alif Lam Mim Thalika al-Kitabu la rayba fi, you see Surah Baqarah, I see my Habib al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look with the eyes of the Sahaba and the Azwaj Mutahharat. They saw something else. That is why our teachers always mention, why is it, do you wonder why the Quran wasn't written in book form in the time of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Because they had the Quran standing and walking in front of them. كَانَ يَمْشِي بَيْنَ النَّاسِ, he would walk amongst them. They would look to him for the Quran, and they would recite of him, and they would be inspired by him. That he was the walking, talking Quran for the Sahaba. Read the Quran. That is the beautiful miracle of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that is amongst us. We always want to say that how would it have been if we would have seen the beautiful, yani the moon splitting in front of our eyes. How would it have been to see the, you know, the water coming forth from the fingers Mubarak of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But how is it of eyes that can have the Quran in front of them and still wonder about these beautiful things when we have the miracle of the Quran in front of us? He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left us. Anybody who joins and connects to the Book of Allah has no doubt seen the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Them two are not yani independent of each other. Together they will always remain. The Musannif alayhi rahmah, he mentions the hard words as is his taraz. He says, وَمَعْنَا الْفَخْمِ الْأَذِيمُ فِي نَفْسِهِ وَالْمُفَخَّمْ الْمُعَذَّمْ عِنْدَ غَيْرِهِ والمشذب الظاهر الطول مع النحافة ورجل الشعر مسترسله والعقيقة في شعر الرأس ووفره جعله وفرة وهي الشعر النازل عن شحمة الأذن إذا لم يصل إلى المنكبين وأزهر مشرق اللون نيره وأزج الحواجب منقوسها مع الطول والثوابت الكاملات وأقنى العرنين طويل الأنف مع دقة الأرنبته. يعني أقنى العرنين, which is that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم had almost like not a short nose but a nose which was prominent, مع دقة أرنبته في وصله بعض ارتفاع, that in the bridge of the nose was a slight raise. صلى الله عليه وسلم. الله الله. والأشم مرتفع قصبة الأنف والأشنب أبيض الأسنان مع بريق وتحديد فيها والمفلج منفرج الثنايا. مفلج, he says that there was space between the teeth. Like we mentioned, the teeth, it was only the thanaya, the front two teeth. They would have a slight gap between them. That shows beauty. To have gaps anywhere else, that was classed as something which was aib. And this is something which would be rectified. But to have a gap between the front two teeth was something which was considered of beauty. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Wa dumiyati suratun min rukhami wa nahwihi wal badin as-samin as-simanan mu'tadilan. These are all the words that we explained as we went along. Wal mutajarrid al-udw al-ari an al-sha'ri wal labbati al-nuqratu allati fawqa sadr wal rahbi al-wasi' wa sa'il al-atraf طويلها طولا معتدلا وخنصار الأخمسين متجافيهما عن الأرض والأخمس الموضع الذي لا يمس الأرض عند الوطئ من وسط القدم والمسيح الأملس والينبوع يتباعد وإذا زال قلعا وإذا مشى رفع رجليه بقوة. When he صلى الله عليه وسلم would walk, he'd walk with firm, clean and strong steps. وذريع المشي واسع الخطوة خلقة ولا تكلفا والملاحظة النظر باللحاظ وهو شق الأيدي مما يلي الصدغة ويسوق أصحابه يقدمهم بين يديه ويبدر يبتدئ. So the Musannif continues now after mentioning some of those hard words. وكان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أفلج الثنيتين إذا تكلم ذِيَ كَالنُّورِ يَخْرُجُ مِنْ بَيْنِ ثَنَايَاهُ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. Allah. And he closed your eyes and see that smile of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He says the beautiful hadith of Tirmizi Sharif as well. He says the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he says he had a gap between the front two teeth of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. إِذَا تَكَلَّمَ, when he would speak, ri'a kanur, it was as if he was show, as if ri'a, you could have said ra'a, you could have said they would see, but he says ri'a kanuri, he says it was as if you were seeing. So he says the people would see, and why he's mentioned that, because in Tirmizi Sharif, in the commentaries of Tirmizi Sharif, it mentions, he says some of the sahaba would say when he sallallahu alayhi wasallam smiled, we had to look away. That was the nur that would be emanating from the face of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would smile, we would shy away. He says we would just look away. So how would they describe this? He says because it captured our eyes. A single glance would capture would captivate your eyes. And but you would have to look away because it's too much for you to look at. He says, what is it that then gave that nur? He says, was it his teeth itself that we described as white? They were pure, brilliant, pearly whites. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, or was it a gap that was from something from behind it? There was a difference. That's why it says, ri'a kanur. He says, it was as if you could see light. Because he says, because it wasn't certain whether it was the teeth or was it something behind it that would be shining forth from it. We know from the hadith of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala an, that she lost a needle in the night. Pitch dark, there was no moon that night. And it was dark. And the Prophet ﷺ walks in, smiles, and everything illuminates. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. These things we can't even, it's like, what are these stories? These are witnesses, eyewitness accounts of that beauty, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Kanuri yakhruju min bayni thanayahu. He says, as if there was light shining between from beneath that gap. That's what just gave it even more beauty. Wa kana sallallahu alayhi wasallam ahsan al-bashari qadaman. He says, who's gonna give us this? The description, he says, he was the most beautiful of people when we look towards his feet. He says, so we've gone from his beautiful face, Mubarak. We saw his beautiful eyes. We saw his beautiful eyelashes and his eyebrows. We saw his beautiful nose. We spoke about his beautiful wide mouth. The wasil jabini, smooth cheeks. Now let's move down. We said he had wide shoulders. He had a beautiful, strong chest. He had long arms and his strong forearms. He had fleshy hands and he had fleshy feet. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, now let's describe his feet. Who's going to be looking at his feet? Most of the Sahaba. But the ones that riwayat that we have, most of them are from the children. The children who would always be lower down and they would be seeing to the beautiful feet. Because he says, and Maymunata binti Kardam, from one of the Sahabiyat of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who's a daughter of a Sahabi. So the parents of Sahabas, companions of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, their daughter says, قالت رأيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فما نسيت طول إصبع قدمه السبابة على سائر أصابعه رواه الإمام أحمد رحمه الله تعالى. She says, I'll give you my account. He says, I look towards the feet of the Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم. They're the feet that have been on top of the world, on top of the universe, on top of creation. On the night of Isra al-Mi'raj, all of creation went below the feet of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Just imagine that, to have the ability to see that. These Sahaba, Hazrat Maymuna bint Kardam radiallahu ta'ala anha wa ardaha, she says, Ra'aytu, I saw the feet of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, fama nasitu, I have never ever forgotten that manzar ever since. He says, the tula isba'i qadami his sababati. How I can describe to you that his toes were longer than the other fingers of the feet of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This is something that, some of the hadith have mentioned these words about the hands. They said, anybody, Ibn Hajar rahmatullahi alayhi mentions that everybody who's mentioned it without doing ta'yid, that was it the hands or the feet, they said, because of this hadith, we understand that it was the sababa, the long toe, the biggest toe of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the longest compared to the others, not on the hands of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They were different. It was the middle finger, the wusta, that was the longest of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was the strongest. How would it be to describe the feet of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that they had beautiful, fleshy, they were strong, but they were, despite those that had looked like that they had walked, They weren't shy of any work. The Prophet ﷺ's feet had been those that could walk on an average day before Nubuwwah up and down. Anybody who's been to Makkah, may Allah all get us there, inshallah. Let us go there again and again, inshallah. Those who have seen Ghar Hira, the Mount of Hira, where revelation began, that's a far way. And to walk, we have a problem with this heat. Try the heat of the Arabian heat, then try to walk up in that heat. And that'll be a normal, normal day. Day to day, up and down, up and down. That's hard. But the Prophet ﷺ would do it with ease. And despite that, his feet were not rough. His feet, as it comes, yambu' and hulma. The Prophet ﷺ, when if you poured water, it would just skate, it would skim off the feet of the Rasul. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's the feet of the Rasul. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This hadith is mentioned by Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. And he's narrated this hadith. That's a beautiful, one of the great imams of one of the great madhabs, the four rightly guided imams of this beautiful ummah of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We should know he's one of those, has a high rank, real high rank. Who's his teacher? His teacher will tell you, we know no doubt it's Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala. Likes the like that his teacher is no doubt one of those, the likes of Sayyidina Bishr al-Hafi, say that Bish al-Hafif is one of from classes one from amongst the greatest of the awliya of the Rasul, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the greatest from the friends of Allah. And he's one of those that when he would ask, he would be given. And his life was never like that from before. But towards the end of his life, he had a change. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed him with a change and made him a friend of Allah. May Allah make us of those, inshallah. We've all got lives that, I've got a past that we don't want to speak about. But so did them saints. And some of the saints had them past. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala changed them because of adab towards Allah's shi'ar. And no doubt when he passes away, Sayyidina Bish al-Hafi, he says, you've passed away, but your student, Sayyidina Ahmed ibn Hanbal, he passed away before his teacher. So somebody sees Sayyidina Bish al-Hafi in his dream. And he asks Sayyidina Bish al-Hafi, he says, how were you after your death? He says, I was fine because of this and because of this. Allah blessed me with this and this. He says, Wa aina Ahmad ibn Hanbal? He says, where is Ahmad ibn Hanbal, your student? So he could have said, he says, he's my student. So obviously he was below me, he was down there, he was doing this, but he can't get to my maqam. He says in his riwayah, we're telling you, and Habib Ali Jifri told me this. I still remember it, the way he described it, subhanAllah. He says, وَرَفَأَ رَأْسَهُ وَرَفَأَ رَأْسَهُ وَرَفَأَ رَأْسَهُ حَتَّى سَقَتَتْ عَمَامَتُهُ. He says, عَنْ رَأْسِهِ أَفْوَنْ. He says, he lifted his head, and he raised his head, and he kept raising his head until his amama fell off his head. He says he had to look so high up to see the maqam of Ahmad ibn Hanbal, rahmatullah alayhi, the one we're speaking about. He says, بِمَاذَا تَفَوَّقَ عَلَيْكَ. He says, he's your student. He says, how did he get above you? He says, you're down here, and he's all the way up there. And his student has overtaken the master. If those who understand that quote. How did he get there? He says, تَزَوَّجَ فَقَامَ بِسُنَّةِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَّمْ وَلَمْ أَصْنَعْ. He says he got married. He did nikah. He fulfilled the great sunnah of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Walam asna, I didn't have the opportunity to do that. He's already got on top of me. And he beat me by that. A sunnah of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that some people take for granted. A sunnah. And he got above me. He says, wa anjaba al awlad fa ahsana tarbiyatahum ala al ilmi wa al dhikr. He says, walam asna. He says, walahu, he says, he had children. He raised them upon knowledge and good actions. And he says, for him was the reward of everything that they did. وَلَمْ أَصْنَعْ. He says, I didn't have the opportunity because I didn't do step number one, get married. He says, he's already beating me. And then he says, وَأُذِّيَ وَأُذِّبَ وَأُذِّيَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَصَبَرَ وَلَمْ أَصْنَعْ. He says, Ahmad ibn Hanbal was the one that he was tested and he was punished. And he was tormented and he was locked up. And he says he did sabr and he always never lost hope in the great promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to stand firm for the right and stand firm against the dhulm. And he did sabr. I never had the opportunity to do that. He says, بِهَذَا هَذِهِ الثَّلَاثِ تَفَوَّقَ عَلَيَّ. He says, by these three, he ranked over me, way above me. Ahmad ibn Hanbal, we should know these great imams. Why? Because they are being hijacked. Who are these imams? We can study their uloom. We can get to their maqam. Even if we tried, even if we were given lives, one life, two lives, three lives, 10 lives, we would not be able to do what Allah blessed them beautiful beings to do. We ask Allah, inshallah, to keep us firmly on the manhaj of these great imams. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to never move in away from this beautiful manhaj and path that they gathered us on, because they are our link to being seen the lens of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa baraka wa sallam. And here he continues, wa kana sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fi saqihi hamusha. He says the blessed shins of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the lower leg of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was slender. And he wasn't a fat, he wasn't too chunky, if you will. It wasn't too thin. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's feet were beautiful, slender. We're here ma'mudatun fi saqin, and it's a quality which is And it's something which is praiseworthy. وَكَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يَمْشِي. Here, from here, the Musannif is now going to begin describing the beautiful walk of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is something that we need to know. How do we walk? When we look towards our, you know, those that we see on the TV screens, how they're walking like that, you know, they're arrogant and boastful. People look towards us and say, whoa, that's a really cool way to walk. I want to walk like that. Everybody want to be like Mike. But they don't. We want to be like Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So then how does he walk? And how, what's going to change for us when we hear about this walk? How many of us are then going to change our walk to walk to be looking like the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? By Allah, if we can implement these, then we, when we are walking, will be beloved to Allah because we look like His beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Inshallah, we'll continue with this next week. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us tawfiq and understanding of the true nature of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so we can love him, be like him, follow him inwardly and outwardly. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.